morning. My name is Carrie Hoagland, and I welcome you to First Presbyterian Church, Battle Creek, Michigan. The Lord is listening. God is calling. We are here to answer God's call. Be of good courage. The one who loves us best is near.
This is Jesus Shall Reign Where'er the Sun, number 265.
We know, Most Holy One, that we are not holy. We know, Most Forgiving Lord, that we struggle to forgive. We know, God, whose faithfulness extends beyond our imagination, that we too easily walk away. Draw near to us in this time, loving God, that we become more like you. Listen in this moment as we meet with you in the silence of our hearts. Friends, hear the good news. Thomas, who doubted, is almost Thomas who was willing to go wherever Jesus wanted, even at the cost of his life. Believe in new possibilities. Peter, who denied, is also he who spread the faith. We are in Christ, who is making all things new, and all things are possible with God. The scripture this morning is Jeremiah 29, verse 4 through 7 and 10 through 14. Thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, to all the exiles from whom I have sent into exile, from Jerusalem to Babylon. Build houses and live in them. Plant gardens and eat what they produce. Take wives and have sons and daughters. Take wives for your sons and give your daughters in marriage, that they may bear sons and daughters. Multiply there and do not decrease. But seek the welfare of the city where I have sent you into exile, and pray to the Lord on its behalf, for in its welfare you will find your welfare. For thus says the Lord, only when Babylon's 70 years are completed will I visit you, and I will fulfill to you my promise and bring you back to this place. For surely I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord, plans for your welfare and not for harm, to give you a future with hope. Then when you call upon me and come to pray to me, I will hear you. When you search for me, you will find me. If you seek me with all your heart, I will let you find me, says the Lord, and I will restore your fortunes and gather you from the nations in all the places where I have driven you, says the Lord, and I will bring you back to the place from which I sent you into exile.
How many times did you hear somebody say, boy, am I gonna be glad when 2020 is over? As if you knew, as if you could tell that 2021 was gonna be great. How could you know that? You can't know that. Now, it is traditional for people to give the backhanded comment about a year and say, well, it's got to be better than last year, right? People say things like that. They do. But this year, oh my gosh, this year there is every reason to feel that way. We have no guarantees. We don't know what we'll be. But this year has been hard, and it's been difficult, and it's been a year that has left us without a lot of confidence and without a lot of certainty for how it is that we can go about living our lives. Jeremiah, in our text today, was speaking to a group of people just like us. People who had lost a lot, some of them everything. And they had no clue what was going to be. We know people, and there certainly are people who've lost everything. And we don't know what will be. So when Jeremiah was giving his message to all of those people, Jeremiah, you know, there's always somebody in church who makes fun of you when you're trying to speak and give the word of the Lord and help people get connected. And Jeremiah had two groups of people who were trying to, be the prophet instead of him. And the first group of people were those who said, you know, this is awful. We can call these people the Eeyore group. Now, they wouldn't have known Eeyore in ancient Babylon, but Winnie the Pooh is cultural knowledge in our time. And these are the people who wore t-shirts all around town, and the front of the t-shirt said, don't try to happy me up, right? And the back of the t-shirt said, life is hard. That was the first group that he was preaching to. And the second group was completely on the other side of the coin. They were the, you know, there's nothing really wrong group. Yeah. These are the people who, when you break your leg, they come to your house and they say to you, "Well, you still got one good leg that works. What are you so glum about? Come on, man." These are the people who say, "You know, even though we're living in Babylon, even though we're in exile, even though we're in pandemic and we can't do anything, everything's okay. Really, no, everything's okay." Neither one of those groups is terribly helpful, are they? God came to Jeremiah and said, "You know, Jeremiah, you can sort this out, not by picking one, but by recognizing that they're both wrong." They're both wrong. If we are going to find grace in the midst of exile, if we are going to live lives of faith as we go through the exile experiences, we can avoid both of these sides, and we can recognize that the call of God is to engage our lives and to both be a blessing and receive blessing. To both receive grace and give grace. That this is what God has called us to do, even in an exile experience like we're living in now. We know what this is like. We're living in that moment right now. And it is very tempting to move to one side or the other, right? But God tells us that it is in seeking to be children of grace, in seeking to discover God's presence, that we will be discovered. Great news. Great news. A few years ago, there was a movie out that some of you, I'm sure, saw that I would recommend on Netflix if you haven't seen it, called, The Best Exotic Marigold Hotel. Best Exotic Marigold Hotel. Spoiler alert, I'm going to tell you all about it. So, you know, it's worth seeing anyway. It's really good. And it's about this group of British retirees who decide that they just really can't afford to live where they've been in England because the pound is, you know, so pricey. So they decide, hey, what about India? India would be inexpensive. And they see these advertisements for the best exotic Marigold Hotel. And it is this wonderful, wonderful place they can retire and they can afford to live, and all their dreams will come true. Yeah? So they all go. And the movie follows their travel there and their experience there, and they all have dreams when they go, and they all have the sense that, you know, this is going to be good. And one by one, all of them fall by the wayside. One by one, well, first of all, the hotel is not really best and it's not really very exotic. And it goes downhill from there. And their dreams and their hopes, they don't quite get to where they had hoped that they would go. And in this last scene, there is this writer who is one of the three, Judy Dench, or one of the group, it's more than three, and she is writing in the early morning light and reflecting on their experiences. And this is what she said.
"The only real failure is the failure to try. And the measure of success is how we cope with disappointment. As we always must. We came here, and we tried, all of us in our different ways. Can we be blamed for feeling that we are too old to change? Too scared of disappointment to start it all again? We get up in the morning. We do our best. Nothing else matters.
It turns out all of us are starting over this year. It turns out this experience of leaving something or someone or both behind is something that all of us are trying to manage. And the word of the Lord for us through Jeremiah today is that we have the opportunity to live in grace, to give it, to receive it, to be God's children, even when we're not sure of almost anything. It is enough to be God's children. So let us find the courage every morning to get up and do our best for God. And maybe in so doing, we will discover that even in moments such as this, even in times such as we live, there can be wonderful results in starting over. May it be so for us.
This is number 175, Seek Ye First.
Thank you.
us pray. Most merciful and ever-loving God, you who have been with your children through generations of exile experiences, you who have been the comfort of the lost and the forlorn, you who have given us what we need when we need it through generations, draw near to us in these days. Remind us that we did not create our own lives, but they are a gift. And that even in the midst of the most disheartening circumstance, we can discover anew, fresh every day, what it means to live as your children, who know that life is more than the sum of its parts in any day, who know that our ability to be encouraging and to love one another is not limited by distance. Your children who know that our call is neither to give up nor pretend that there's no problem, that our call is to let you live in and through us, that grace may abound. We pray, O God, in these days for those who need you in a special way, for all of those in hospice care, those who've either been are new there or even have been a while, for those who find this pandemic to be making the experience of physical frailty or frazzled emotion to be so much worse. We pray for those who are recovering from surgery and ask for meaningful healing and for your spirit to make the good work of doctors even better. And for those who are recovering from COVID-19. The disease of the season that is wreaking havoc with lives right and left. Lord, we pray for good things, for return to health, for lives recovered, for no long-term effect. And we pray for no transmission to anyone else. Lord, we pray for our world on this day. I can't remember a time at the turn of a year when the world seemed to be in such disarray. And we ask that you who love everyone in it would help us all to discover the paths that you have laid before us, the good works that you have created that we can walk in them in the days ahead. Grant that we might look at this new year not as a chance to rest, but as a chance to be your hands and feet, to be your life, to be your people in this world. We pray, O God, for our country. We pray for each person in this divided nation. And we pray for those who think like us, and we pray for those who don't think like us. We pray for those whose thoughts on current events make us smile, and we pray for those whose expressions and analysis of current events make us angry. You, O God, are so much bigger than all we understand or know. And so we ask that you would help us to embody your life and love, that we would differentiate from hate, that we would overcome hatred with goodness and love. Most merciful God, you above all know where we need healing in our hearts and in our bodies, where we need encouragement in our minds and our souls. Come and do what needs to be done, that we may be restored to the joy of life with you. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, he who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. So, friends, it is now time in our service for our morning offering. What, you didn't see the UPS man drop a plate at your door this week? No. We haven't done that in a while, but I would like us to think about that again each week. Yes, no community of faith can survive without the support of those who are a part of it. Yes, any gifts are appreciated and even needed in these days. But as much or more than that, I want us to think about what it means for us on Sunday when we have the offering after the proclamation of the word, right? We do that on purpose. It is a response to God. And so one of the things that I would like you to think about this morning, in this particular moment, has something in today's service, in the music, in the singing, in the reading, in the scripture, in the word, has something struck you that helps you to think, I could do that for God this week. I could offer this particular thought, action, devotion thing to God who loves me more than anybody else this week. So I'd like you to think about that. I'd like you to think about, boy, the weeks go either slow or fast, don't they? It seems to depend on the day. And what in that week would have marvelous redemptive value because it was our offering to the God we serve? So let us pray. Thank you, God, that we can have an offering without an offering, that we can appreciate the offertory without hearing it, and that we can know that we have responded to you, listened for your call, paused to be still, to sense your nudging. Help us, O God, this week, to offer all we have and are to you, that they may be vehicles of grace, that they may do wonderful things in this world you have given us, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
This is Shine, Jesus, Shine, number 192. Bring us shine.
And now, friends, go out into the world in peace. Not because the world is a peaceful place, not because life is easy, but because there is always grace, there is always opportunity, and every day we can get up and do our best for God, who loves us best. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. But before we finish, let me do one more thing. It is my understanding that this church has a Zoom coffee hour. That there is a Zoom coffee hour you can be a part of. And I will be there today, and I would like to see you there too. Thanks. See you.